I'm Etzion from Haifa, Israel. Today is the 9th of November, 2024. As usual, we start our sharing with a musical piece. This musical piece is being called Night in Tunisia. Wonderful. So, let's see yes. What we are going to do. So we'll continue reading the book of Genesis. And after the book of Genesis, I'll share again a letter from Mehera. On Mehera, I could have given 10 more sessions just on Mehera. So we'll start with this a little bit, and then we'll move to Mehera, and we'll talk about the circumstance maybe a little bit, depends what I will be feeling about this.
Well, yeah, very good.
We stopped here last week.
Yes.
We're dealing with the issue of Cain and Hevel. Or Cain and Abel. In Abel, as they translated it, as usually wrongly. This is not Abel, this is Hevel. We hear, when we hear the names, Ka, Ad, He, Hevel. It's very soft, it's airy. Cain is earthly. Hevel is the spiritual aspect. These two aspects are the physical aspect, material aspect, and the spiritual aspect, both these aspects are part of our consciousness, our psychic makeup. This is not some kind of old, two strange individuals, two brothers that were jealous and is a god like this one, a demon like this one, and one became jealous and killed the other one. These are all analogies of all kinds of things that are happening within our souls. And this is what is being explained here. And it's crucial for us to understand this psychological issues within ourselves. It is nothing external, but we see it externally that the so-called material people on earth who are often, you can think, the selfish egoists who care only for hoarding wealth, and the spiritual people who are so-called supposedly shy and feeble often and scattered, and they don't know how to take over humanity and lead it to spirituality. Our work on earth is the offering that we bring before the circle of Yahweh Elohim. When we act, we produce energy, and this energy is used for the needs of cosmic evolution. Yahweh Elohim, I call it, is a fraternity of the perfect masters, the leaders of humanity. The responsibility of mankind is to generate these energies. Cain tills the land. He sees the goal in improving the mineral world on which the plant kingdom rests for the benefit of humankind. Hevel operates on a higher level in the animal world, which is actually the pinnacle of creation, which mankind must guide and elevate. So this level of consciousness will reach the level of human consciousness as soon as possible. This is man's goal. Man is, in fact, the primary and fundamental principle in creation. Is not the byproduct of creation. The issue of humankind, where is she standing in the evolutionary spiritual system, and what is her personal relationship towards her surroundings? Humankind is a link between the spiritual and the material. The fall of humankind into matter blocked the connection between spirit and matter. The missing link in evolution is not a kind of ape, but a human wielding his spiritual responsibility. The Yahweh Elohim circle is actually a mirror that presents man with his inner structure as it is. It is a very difficult experience to observe the present childish stage in which man finds himself. Yahweh Elohim plays the role of the Supreme Father of creation as head of the human race. When Cain looks in the mirror, realizes that his path is not accepted. He is not walking the right path, aiming at attaining super consciousness, which is the goal of creation. He strives to achieve his goals by virtue of earthly achievements. He works very hard to fulfill his desires, but he always fails. It fills his soul with anger and rage, which he directs at the object that is seemingly on the right path. In his childish perception, he seeks to destroy the destination that the Supreme Father loves, quote unquote. And here is it is after the assassination of Hevel by Cain, meaning actually that we within ourselves destroy the spiritual man and make the physical man as a ruler. within ourselves. And the Lord said unto Cain, where is Abel thy brother? And he said, I know not. Am I my brother's keeper? And he said, what hast thou done? The voice of thy brother's blood crieth unto me from the ground. And now cursed art thou from the ground, which hath opened her mouth to receive the brother's blood from thy hand. When thou tillest the ground, it shall not henceforth yield unto thee her strength. A fugitive and a wanderer shalt thou be in the earth. And Cain said unto the Lord, my punishment is greater than I can bear. Took him a while to figure out that there is a word called responsibility in the beginning, as just the same, the story that we supposedly seen in the garden, and we showed off responsibility just the same. What is sin? In Hebrew, sin means missing the mark. And what is the aim? The goal is focusing the mind on spirit. It is a focus on the material alone that causes all human problems. The land is important, but not as an end, but as a means, as a scaffolding used to build the house. And at the end of the work, it must to be dismantled. Does Yahweh Elohim not know what happened to Hevel? After all, Hevel belongs to this lofty circle. The circle of superconscious people knows everything that is happening, but allows things to happen. Hevel is aware of what is about to happen, and is actually sacrificing himself to allow the processes of creation to continue, even when humans have decided to destroy themselves spiritually, which will lead to their extinction. We will discuss this phenomenon of sacrificial offerings later on, and what it means from a spiritual point of view. You can see below what was explained about the binding of Isaac. Where Abraham, Lord Abraham, it is going to, we are going to discuss it later on. We know that this is a very famous story. Abraham, the patriarch, took his son Isaac, or Yitzhak in Hebrew, and the Lord ordered him to sacrifice it on the hills of Jerusalem, supposedly. We are going to study this scene later on. But what we see also behind, between the lines, what happened after 2,000 years after that, or 1,500 years, we heard about the rabbi of Nazareth, whom you call Jesus, who sacrificed himself, the spiritual aspect of humanity, was being sacrificed so the creation will be able to continue. And we will deal, there was the binding of Isaac, we will deal also with, it touches the sacrifice of Jesus and all the other martyrs along the way. And we'll explain why such things are happening. And we'll try to understand why, what is the true meaning of the murder of Hevel by Cain. What we are dealing with now is a very deep subject, and what I am trying to express here is unsatisfactory and, frankly, somewhat superficial. I am aware that I am unable to express what I really feel in the depth of things. Consciousness and language do not have this ability. I try to provoke thought here and look deeper into our souls, to look in the merciless mirror, to mature and take spiritual responsibility. Only when we take spiritual responsibility will the meaning of what the Torah says here become clear. While I have been meditating on the phrases of the Hebrew Torah, I have observed depth runs which I couldn't express because language and consciousness came to the limit. The person or the persons who wrote this book had super consciousness, and when you have super consciousness, you can portray pictures that cannot be expressed by words. So I had some feeling about this, but I cannot. What I have been doing, it's a maximum of what the language can do. But there is much more behind the veil. Behold, thou hast driven me out of this day from the face of the land, and from thy face shall I be hid, and I shall be a fugitive and a wanderer in the earth. It will come to pass that whosoever findeth me will slay me. This is what the kind says to the Lord. Humans who expelled themselves from the consciousness of heaven and sank to the level of minerals, from the point of view of consciousness, expel themselves from the level as well, and in fact, trashed their role in spiritual evolution. Once again, we must look at things as a reflection in the mirror, provided by the circle of Yahweh Elohim. God has never expelled people from the paradise state. This is a result of the free will made possible in this sphere. And it was a conscious choice of people. The loss of focus of consciousness on the purpose of creation is actually a symptom of mental illness. The internal mental structure is like a pyramid whose lower layer is the physical body, then the emotional layer, above it the mental layer, and above them the apex, which is the spiritual focus of the person. People turn this pyramid upside down, and so the physical layer is at the top, and the upper focus is buried below. This is the reason for people's mental illness and disordered behavior throughout history. And the Lord say unto him, therefore, whosoever slayeth Cain, vengeance shall be taken on him sevenfold. And the Lord set a sign for Cain, lest any finding him should smite him. This brings some curious questions, because there were Adam and Eve and two brothers. And here the Torah says that there are many more individuals, humans around, who are now after Cain to kill him. The Torah doesn't say it here. What is being portrayed actually is the law of karma. Whatsoever you created will come back upon you. 70 is an expression of something multiplied sevenfold. But we can also see that it refers to a period of activity which usually has seven periods, that is, the 7 days of creation in the first chapter. What this means here is that revenge causes a backlash, and the backlash demands a backlash indefinitely. People have been trapped in a vicious circle from which there is no way out. A victimized person demands that the guilty be punished. And the person who has been punished, his inner hate only grows stronger and thus seeks revenge. And so people on earth move in cycles of mutual hatred that never end. When we take revenge on those whom we consider guilty of a crime, we do not close the circle, because the person we accuse sees justification in his actions. He is, in fact, taking revenge on those who hurt him before. And the continuation of the cycle of harm and revenge returns as a vicious circle. It has no end, and so as the evil grows stronger without limit. If we would refer to this so-called correction system or the law, this what humans invented as law, they don't cure anything. They just make things worse. The justice system is actually the main key for producing evil. They don't understand it because they don't have any spiritual understanding whatsoever of these good people. They are good people, the lawyers and the judges and the police, etc. They're seeking to grab all the bad guys and lock them up, so all the good guys will have a good time. It's not working. It's only getting worse. Later we will see again and again these pairs of brothers, Isaac and Ishmael, Jacob and Esau, Joseph and his brothers, Moses and the people of Israel, the prophets and the tribes, and on throughout the generations. We could keep on seeing that there is a material aspect of humanity and spiritual aspect. And externally, we see that there are spiritual people and materialistic people. But the truth is that everything is within ourselves. We have to understand it. Once again, we see this mythological story, which seems to be another innocent story for children, in the style of Andersen's fairy tales, as a powerful expression of Rabban Moshe's world encompassing consciousness. Rabban, in Hebrew, in ancient Hebrew, a master, a rabbi, which is being derived from this expression, Rabban, Rav. Today is a person who is expert in the commentaries on the Torah. Because I don't mean any disrespect, but some rabbis are real masters, some are actually teacher of the holy books. The stories of the Torah are, in fact, a very thorough work of research into the levels of consciousness, their development, the challenges and obstacles we face as humans, move through creation subject to cruel and controllable events. The man who chose the consciousness of Cain as his focus condemned himself to be born again in the earthly sphere without purpose, without aim till the end of time. This is what it means to move and wander in the land. A consciousness centered on material attainments locks the course of the soul, the individual, into the material sphere. Thus, man is trapped in ignorance, which locks him in unending suffering. All is due to free will, which is a key principle in creation. All we need to do is focus our inner gaze on the transcendent values projected from the circle of Yahweh Elohim, inviting us all to join him when we decide to transform Cain's consciousness into Hebel's. From the moment we have made this decision and we will cling to it at all costs, we are guaranteed to join this exalted circle, and our suffering on earth will be reduced. Actually, the poem, I have described it before, and they maybe don't remember why God chose the offering of Cain. Cain offered the vegetables before the Lord, and Hevel offered the slaughtered animals, and he cooked them, grilled them on the fire. The simile here is our inner work of destroying sanskaras, which is all this issue of sacrifice in the Torah and the legends, the destruction of sanskaras. Now, the vegetable the sacrificial of the vegetation is a superficial work of destroying sanskaras, because the sanskaras, plant sanskara within our minds, are the loose and shallow sanskaras, and the animal sanskara within our minds are the real deep ingrained tough sanskara which we have created due to the process of creation. And if we would know how to do our real work properly, we won't allow the animalic sanskaras to die within our subconscious mind and solidify them. Sanskaras are like what happens to the fish in the ocean. They die, and their skeletons, some are being eaten by others, some simply sink to the bottom of the ocean, and their skeletons form the crust of the earth. The limestone, if you look at the limestone, you see it's full of skeletons. This represents the process of forming hearts and scars within our subconscious minds. At a certain stage, we cannot eradicate anymore. How do you eradicate some scars? the hard crust of the earth under the ocean, by earthquakes and volcano eruptions. And this resembles the process of suffering that we have to undergo in order to destroy our innocent scars. If we are not doing the work voluntarily, the spiritual exercise. Now here I bought a portion let me look at it for a second. Okay, I'll read it because it will bring and conclude our conversation. Among the scrolls discovered in the Judean desert are excerpts from the book called The Book of Jubilees. The manifestation of the various generations from the creation till for a few couple of thousand years. In the chapter 4, that reads verse 2-6, and on the first of the third Jubilee, Cain killed Abel because we received his sacrifice from his hand, from the hand of Cain. We did not receive, the spiritual hierarchy is speaking, and he killed him in the field, and his blood cried out from the earth to heaven, while he was crying out that he had been put to death. And God reproved Cain to Abel because his death, an extended time, had given him on earth because of the blood of his brother, and cursed his life on earth. Therefore it is written in the tablets of heaven, cursed is a man who strikes his neighbor secretly, and all who witness say, Amen. And a man who saw and did not say would be as damned as he was. Therefore, we bear witness when we come before the Lord our God of all the sins that will be committed in heaven and on earth, and in light and darkness and in all. And at the end of this Jubilee, Cain was put to death in that year, and his howl fell upon him, and he died in his house, and he shall be put to death by stone, for with a stone he put Abel to death, and with a stone he was put to death in the law of justice. The text is from the edition of the Book of Jubilee of Kanawana Nevma. The full book was discovered in Ethiopia and preserved in Ge'ez script. This is a special language of the Ethiopians. And it was from there, presumably, Preso escaped the destruction of the temple. 200 years before the destruction, about there was a civil war going on inside the Judea or the then Israel. 200 years before the destruction of the temple, they were fighting over the control of the temple, because the temple gave the priests a tremendous power, or the owners of the temple. And the original rightful priest escaped and buried the library of the temple in the Judean desert and put some of it to Egypt. Some of them escaped to Egypt, and there they built a temple there, and most likely, because Jews had connections with Ethiopia, with the Queen of Sheba, who met Solomon, most likely some of these books went to Ethiopia. There is also a legend that the Ark of the Covenant is being held in Ethiopia, in one of the monasteries. It's a very strong legend about this. Now, after this session, we'll move to the third age. We identified three ages in the book of Genesis. The first age is the natural evolution of states of consciousness, which solidified as forms of the physical world. The second age is a conscious creation under the supervision of the master. That's the second chapter of Genesis. And now we move to the story of the flood, where humanity destroyed itself, reached a state of evil, that evil destroys itself. And this, since then, there were non-stop attempts to help us, humanity, to come back to the Edenic state, which we refuse to share till now. We humans refuse to heal, come back to our spiritual position. That's what happens. Okay? That's the stone stuff. And most of humans don't understand what's written here. They see it as some kind of fairy tales, stories for children, and what is behind the veil. Recently, I started to listen to some lectures by Kabbalists on YouTube, and they say things more or less along the lines I've been saying here. Even I didn't read any book of Kabbalah as a spiritual, as a mystical a line of Judaism. When I was writing this work, I was looking only at the text, the Hebrew text, and there's the inspiration under Baba guidance. This is already the 16th session of Genesis, and if you're curious to know what was being offered, you can go back. It's in the archive of the Baba Zoom, and you can look at it. From session after session, I'm explaining as much as I could the meaning of this unusual book, Wisdom, which, according to all the philosophers of the world, is presumably the most, the greatest work of spirituality ever given to humankind, the Book of Moses. Because he was he was writing what the avatar dictated to him. They were sitting together in the circle, the masters, writing this book. The scholars and the philosophers don't understand how such things are happening. I will go back and would like to continue sharing Mehera's letters to me. Before I went to Meherabad in 1979, as I said, during 1972, I became Baba realized when I saw his picture in the humble center of Keri Ben Shammah in Jerusalem. As soon as I saw his picture, I knew who he was. And presumably what happened, that it was just a flash or experience of divine life, love, which I cannot portray and I cannot give it to somebody else. Only the Lord can, whenever he chooses. That's his Leela. This is his thing. Why is not giving it to the whole world? You have to ask him. But what was, when I received this impulse, this fantastic experience, almost the first thing I have done was to drop this stupid free will and stand face to face with the divine beloved. What's the point of this free will? It is just a binding. It keeps us away from the Lord. But this is a key principle in order to reach the threshold of the Lord. When you reach the threshold of the Lord, if you want to move inside, you have to drop this thing because it is a hindrance. It becomes a hindrance. And as long as we stick to the free will, it cannot help us. Only after we surrender to him fully with him, while dropping. And many people surrender to the Lord or to Baba in order that he will fulfill their will. It's very rife in this community. We surrender to you, so it will make us happy. I surrender to him to make him happy. That was my attitude. I surrender to him, and then I started to think, how can I ease up the burden of the Lord? What can I do for this? Which was, in a way, insane. It's a little bit funny. It's just a speck of dust. It's trying to help the highest of the high. But this is the truth. Because if you take all of us specks of dust and become a mighty configuration, there is a good secret behind all this. As if, how could it be that infinitude broke down to infinite numbers of particles of dust, possibly with consciousness? This is the riddle of creation, this cosmic enigma, which is our right to decipher sooner or later. And we're all in part of this game of search, hide and seek, which makes it all the whole fascination. Okay, we'll read a letter of Mehera. Well, it is being buried. What happened to it? I want to share this letter. Yes, listen to me. Meherazad, June 9th, 1982. I kept on sending letters to Mehera since I visited Meherabad, Meherazad, 1979, with Keri Ben Shammah. And I kept on sending her letters, presumably telling her what I've been doing, because a very strong bond was formed between myself and Mehera, which Mehera initiated the first time. Because after I became Baba, I realized I knew the role of Mehera without reading anything. I simply knew who is she. I knew it by inspiration in a way, presumably. I don't think I read much of Baba books at that time. Even Kerry gave me a few things here and there, and it was mainly in English. We didn't have at that time enough. There was only one little booklet, which was not so easy to read. When I came to Meherabad, Meherazad, 1979, I'm sitting in Baba's room where he dropped his body. Sitting in the corner, I was completely new to the whole thing, and people putting their heads on the pillow in front of Baba's bed and taking his darshan, and but very strange. The whole thing looked to me very strange. People bowing to a chair and kissing a pillow and all these things. And while I was sitting in my corner, all of a sudden the door of Mehera's room, which is the same door that to Baba's room from the inside, from the interior, if you know the building. And she came walking straight to me very forcefully and exclaimed, "Why don't you take Baba's darshan?" in a very forceful, commanding tone. And of course, I obeyed it right away. I did what everybody was doing. I put my head on Baba's pillow next to his bed, or on his bed. And since then, for me, it became a routine. For me, whatsoever Mehera is saying is sacred. From where this bond came, I don't know. I can only guess. Sometimes I'm wondering what happened to all those who were fighting with Rama to save Sita from Ravana. What happened to all the people or beings who participated? What a boon they have gained by saving Sita with our mayor. I think it is the very same individual. And even as some think that maybe it is a role, to my humble understanding, the role of Mehera as being a unique state of consciousness, a unique, I don't know if these phrases are correct to begin with, but these hers is her own unique state of position, never to be achieved again. Or no other individual at all. That's my inner feeling. Dear Etzion, it was written, Mehera was not writing. Mehru, she dictated it to Mehru. A loving J. Meher Baba to you from Meherazad. We much understand and appreciate your desire to spread beloved Baba's name and message of love in Israel, especially among those you know. Your loving concern to do Baba work there is a very worthy aim. The very fact that you and dear Kerry, who love beloved Baba in Israel, is his direct link to this holy land, as it always has been. Kerry was still alive in 1982. From 1980, she moved to a home, and I received the Baba Library from her. 82, I already published, 81, I published a little Baba book, which I called The Story of Ali. And from this little booklet, which I spread in Israel, also our Michal Sivan came, and quite a few others. In this period, Israel is very politically oriented in defending her borders. She has no room or thought for religion, i.e. for the true religion, God's religion of love for all humanity. Everywhere in the world, the situation is very disturbed and the same. 1982, was a war between Israel and Lebanon, the very first war. South of Lebanon, just today, was harbored what they call Arab refugees from the war of 1948. The Arabs started the war of destroying Israel after they refused to accept the two-state solution, which the United Nations decided by majority during 1947. And the Arab world rejected it, the two-state solution. Otherwise, there wouldn't have any conflict, there wouldn't be any refugees, there wouldn't be any problem. But that's what happened. In Baba's time, in Baba's way, Israel and all the world will awaken to his call. He has said he will do his work himself, yet he gives us the opportunity to serve him. Thank you. There should be a continuation of this. Just let me see. It is. This is on my website, MeherBabaIsrael.com, as you can see here. You see this? I have lots of material there about Israel and Keri Ben Shammai and Baba stories and the skits I wrote for Baba for his amusement, etc., etc. As Baba told the English group in the 30s, my work is a conscious realization of myself in all creation. I alone do my work, but I allow you, my close ones, to work for me, so that you have the opportunity to use your talents and capacities selflessly, so as to draw closer to me. So the paradox in working for beloved Baba is that though he is infinite power, yet in his compassion, he gives each of his lovers an opportunity to serve him. His ways are unfathomable. You must be practical and not be impatient and rush matters. When the people are ready, they will accept the avatar. It will be in Baba's time. He alone has the authority. He holds the key. You must be patient. So often, beloved Baba had talked of the new order of things. There will be much upheaval before the ideal world of the new humanity comes about. There is love and brotherhood amongst all nations and peoples. Much love to you, in beloveds, Baba's infinite love from all your Meherabad family. You are fortunate to have beloved Baba, the avatar of the age. You are fortunate to love beloved Baba, the avatar of the age. Be happy in the knowledge that he loves you. In beloved Baba's all-embracing love, Meir. Baba's words are, don't worry, be happy. Obey him and make Baba happy. But before I received all this, all these wonderful instructions from Hera, you know, this is such a precious gift. And I was told it was rare that she was sending messages. I don't know, I didn't inquire about this. I should have asked maybe the ladies who took care of her, Davana, Casey Cook, and others who were fortunate to spend time with Mehera and the women Mandali, take care of them. Rare, 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 rare fortune. Just to know Mehera, we don't understand the ladies who were so fortunate to have tea with Mehera. I see it as a one of the highest boons ever given to humanity by the Avatar. So we couldn't, those who didn't have the rare opportunity of meeting him, he gave us Mehera for 20 years so we can have something coming from her. I've never seen a person who was so dedicated, centered, and pointed on the beloved like Mehera, and to say these expressions are not correct. Because in this dual world, when somebody is centered, there is a possibility not being centered. In the state of Mehera, as you say, it is a unique state. There was no dualism, there was no possibility of not being centered. I can decide, which is crazy, not to be centered on the beloved. I can do it because I'm a human in this dual world. And I can reassume my free will and go on my own way, as we have done when we destroyed the Garden of Eden. I don't think I'm going to do it, which is really totally insane. And this is what happened when we destroyed the Garden of Eden. That was an insane move. And we suffer till now. All endeavors to heal humanity without going back to the spiritual roots are doomed to fail. The wars will continue unabated. All of us want to make an end to war, and while there is war and the injustices and all these things, and the children are dying, and it's quite a horrible thing. I've been to wars many, many times in this lifespan. And Baba gave me very powerful insights during the wars to understand why is this phenomenon is happening and how he is taking advantage of it to uplift us from this valley of tears. As he said, in order to extract a thorn, you have to use a thorn. In order to destroy war, we have to use war. This is a waste because that's the way we have decided. We have chosen it for ourselves. So I'll stop the recording here.